Now, the 2018 prelims examination is over and the paper, it was a little bit tough. So, in this year, there are almost 9 questions from environmental science. And we are happy to inform you that out of these 9 questions, 3 were in our model test. So, let us have a look at the 2018 prelims examination questions and their answers. So, this is the first question in UPSC prelims examination and it is related to the vegetation. Right. So, which of the following leaf modification occurs in the desert areas to inhibit water loss? So, they are saying that what are the leaf modifications of desert plants? Right. And they have given hard and waxy leaves, tiny leaves, thorns instead of leaves. So, we need to know which of these are leaf modification in order to reduce the water loss or in order to avoid the water loss in desert plants. So, these kinds of information we discussed in our regular sessions in our terrestrial biome session, okay, in vegetation, natural vegetation session. So, in desert region, we know that there will be lots of temperature and also humidity will be less. So, because of that, evaporation rate will be more in desert regions. So, that's why the plants in desert, they are adapted to reduce the evapotranspiration. That means the escaping of water through the stomata, through leaves. So, in order to avoid evapotranspiration, the plants in desert region will be having some adaptations. So, the desert plants, they will be having few or no leaves. And if it is having leaves, it will be waxy, it will be leathery or it will be hairy in order to reduce the water loss. So, that means they will be having, some of them will be having leaves, okay, and that leaves will be tiny. Because why it is tiny means why it is reducing their surface area means in order to reduce the water loss. And also sunlight is plenty there. So, the plants, desert plants will be having tiny leaves, okay, and that leaves will be waxy, leathery or hairy also. And most of the desert plants will be lacking the leaves and their leaves will be modified into thorns, into spines, right. And some of the plants will be succulents also, like the cactus. So, here our answer will be D, because hardened waxy leaves, tiny leaves, thorns instead of leaves, all these are leaf modifications in the desert plants. Now, this is the second question in UPSC prelims 2018 and it is related to the National Green Tribunal, a quasi judiciary body and the Central Pollution Control Board. In order to curb the pollution, we are having CPCB, and in order to get the speedy removal of environmental disputes or environmental cases, we are having National Green Tribunal. So, regarding that, we are having a question. How is the National Green Tribunal different from the Central Pollution Control Board? And they are saying that the NGT has been established by an act, whereas the CPCB has been created by an executive order of the government. And second, they are saying that the NGT provides environmental justice and helps reduce the burden of litigation in the higher courts, whereas the CPCB promotes cleanliness of streams and wells and aims to improve the quality of air in the country. Now, regarding this NGT, in our model test also we were put a question on NGT. Okay, so regarding the first statement, they are saying that NGT has been established by an act. Of course, that's a correct statement, because NGT has been established by the National Green Tribunal Act 2010. So, that's why that part is correct. Okay, but they are saying that the second part of the first statement says that CPCB has been created by an executive order of the government. That's a wrong, because CPCB is also a statutory body. So, the CPCB, it's a statutory organization and it has been constituted or established under the provisions of Water Prevention and Pollution Control Act 1974. So, that's why it's a statutory body. So, that's why first statement is wrong. Then regarding the function of NGT, why we established NGT means, that means National Green Tribunal means, in order to release the cases related to environment. In order to get a speedy removal of cases related to environment, we are having NGT. Because there will be lots of cases piled up in the higher courts. So, in order to reduce the burden of litigation in the higher courts, we established a separate court for environment and that is known as NGT. So, it's a quasi-judiciary body. So, the second statement, the NGT provides environmental justice and helps reduce the burden of litigation in the higher courts. So, that's a correct statement, right? Then regarding second, CPCB promotes cleanliness of streams and wells and aims to improve the quality of air in the country. So, that's a correct statement, because CPCB, it has been established under the provisions of Water Prevention and Pollution Control Act 1974. So, that's why cleanliness of streams and wells will be there. And also, this CPCB, it has been entrusted with the powers and functions of Air Prevention and Pollution Control Act 1981. So it is also dealing with air pollution, right? So that's why second part is also correct. That means CPCB promotes cleanliness of streams and wells and aims to improve the quality of air in the country. So here our answer is B, 2 only. Only the second statement is correct. First statement is wrong. So this was the question we discussed about National Green Tribunal in our model test. And in that question, we were discussing about the statements like it is a quasi-judicial body which exclusively deals with the environment-related civil litigations. Then second, National Green Tribunal has been established under the Environment Protection Act 1986. That's a wrong statement. Then the orders by NGT can only be challenged in the Supreme Court. So these were the statements we have given with regard to NGT. And here the first and third statements are only correct. Second statement is wrong because it is not established under the Environment Protection Act 1986. NGT has been established under the provisions of National Green Tribunal Act 2010. Now, this is a question regarding the extinction of species. So, we know that already the Earth has been faced 5 major mass extinctions, like the vanishing of dinosaurs, right? So, that is known as extinctions, the mass removal of some species. Okay, so like that, Earth has already faced 5 mass extinctions, and now we are trending to the 6th mass extinction. And scientists, they are saying that it is due to the human developmental activities. Due to the human activities, okay, we are creating so much of greenhouse gases. All this is leading to global warming, climate change, pollution. So, all these things will lead to the 6th mass extinction. So, scientists are saying that humans will be the reason for the 6th mass extinction. So, mass extinction means the vanishing, the totally vanishing of species. Okay. So, the question is like this. The term 6th mass extinction is often mentioned in the news in the context of the discussion of. So, here the statement which is regarding 6th mass extinction is D. That means mankind's overexploitation, misuse of natural resources, fragmentation or loss of natural habitat, destruction of ecosystems, pollution and global climate change. So, that's the answer here. So, the concept related to these 6th mass extinctions or mass extinctions that were we discussed in our biodiversity module, right? Now, this is the question regarding the carbon fertilization. Which of the following statements best describes carbon fertilization? And A, increased plant growth due to increased concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And B, increased temperature of earth due to increased concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And C, increased acidity of oceans as a result of increased concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Then D, adaptation of all living beings on earth to the climate change brought about by the increased concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. So, what the carbon fertilization mean is the increased concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere that will help the plant growth. Okay, and that increased concentration of carbon dioxide is resulted from the human activities, right? So, that is the term known as carbon fertilization. So, due to the human activities, we will be emitting carbon dioxide to the atmosphere and that will used by the plants as a means for their fertilization. So, they will use that carbon dioxide and their plant growth will increase because they will be utilizing their carbon dioxide for their photosynthesis purposes in order to produce their carbohydrates, right? So, that's why we got the name carbon fertilization. That means this carbon dioxide that will act as a fertilization like that. So, that's why we got the name carbon fertilization. So, carbon fertilization is the effect in which the growing amount of or the larger amount of carbon dioxide present in the atmosphere that will be utilized by the green plants for their photosynthetic activities and their plant growth will increase. Now, the scientists, they are researching on the effect of this carbon fertilization on the agricultural productivity. So, they are saying that there was some increase in agricultural productivity due to this carbon fertilization. Okay, so here our answer is the statement which best describes carbon fertilization is increased plant growth due to increased concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. So, here our answer is A. Now, this is a question regarding international initiative known as PAGE or we can call it as Partnership for Action on Green Economy, a UN mechanism to assist countries transition towards greener and more inclusive economies. And they are asking that in which of the conference it was emerged. So, they have given options as the Earth Summit on Sustainable Development 2002 in Johannesburg, then the United Nations Conference on Sustainable Development 2012, Rio de Janeiro, that means Rio Plus 20 conference, and C, the United Nations and Framework Convention on Climate Change 2015, then the World Sustainable Development Summit 2016 in New Delhi. So this Partnership for Action on Green Economy page, it was established in 2013 as a response to the Rio Plus 20 conference. That means by this United Nations Conference on Sustainable Development 2012, Rio Plus 20 conference, this Partnership for Action on Green Economy was initiated or emerged. And for what it was emerged is, in order to get a greener and more inclusive growth trajectories. So that's why for transition towards greener and more inclusive economies, this page was emerged as a result of this Rio Plus 20 conference. So this page, they brings together 5 UN agencies like the UNDP, UNEP, International Labour Organization, UN Industrial Development Organization, and the UN Institute for Research and Training, like that. So page represents a mechanism to coordinate UN actions on green economy. And also it assists the countries to achieve the sustainable development goals. So here our answer is B. The page was emerged at United Nations Conference on Sustainable Development 2020 at Rio de Janeiro of Brazil. Now this is a question regarding the Pakkai Wildlife Sanctuary, and it is in Arunachal Pradesh. So they asked the question like this: in which one of the following states is Pakkai Wildlife Sanctuary located? And they have saying that Arunachal Pradesh, Manipur, Meghalaya and Nagaland. So regarding this Pakkai, it was a current affair in 2016. So that's why we also made a question on this Pakkai. So why it was a news means or current affair means, this Pakkai Wildlife Sanctuary, it got India Biodiversity Award 2016. Right. So that's why it was in news. So Pakkai Wildlife Sanctuary, it's a wildlife sanctuary in Arunachal Pradesh. So you can locate there. Right. So this Pakkai Wildlife Sanctuary, it was got the India Biodiversity Award for the hornbill conservation programs. So that's why it was in news. Right. So it is in Arunachal Pradesh. So here our answer is A, Arunachal Pradesh. So this was a question we made based on Pakkai Wildlife Sanctuary, like the protected area, and they are well known for, and we mentioned about this Pakkai or Pakkai in Arunachal Pradesh, and also it is famous for hornbill. Now this is another question in UPSC prelims. The definition of critical wildlife habitat is incorporated in Forest Rights Act 2006. Second statement, for the first time in India, bygas have been given habitat rights. Then third, Union Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change officially decides and declares habitat rights for primitive and vulnerable tribes groups in any part of India. So regarding this critical wildlife habitat, it is mentioned or it is defined in the Forest Rights Act 2006. So within the Forest Rights Act, it is defining about the critical wildlife habitat. And by the Section 2 of the Forest Rights Act 2006, it is mentioning that Environment Ministry is the agency to determine this critical wildlife habitat. So as per the Section 2 of this Forest Rights Act 2006, Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change is identified as the agency to determine and define this or notify this critical wildlife habitat. So it is also mentioned in the Forest Rights Act 2006. So that's why first statement is correct. And this Forest Rights Act is also mentioning that Ministry of Tribal Affairs is the nodal ministry for recognizing and vesting of individual and community forest rights. So first statement is correct. And regarding the second statement, we know that bygas is a tribes in Madhya Pradesh. So for the first time in India, in Madhya Pradesh, this bygas have been given the habitat rights. Okay, so that's why second statement is also correct. So the government of Madhya Pradesh, it has given habitat rights to the bygas which are living in the 7 villages of Dinduri district. So the second statement is also correct. Then regarding third statement, Union Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change officially decides and declares habitat rights for primitive and vulnerable tribal groups in any part of India. That's a wrong statement, because Environment Ministry is not declaring these habitat rights. So the procedure for getting these habitat rights is, first of all, the claims for habitat rights will be passed by Gram Sabhas. Then the sub-divisional level committee, they will go through that. Then they will forward that to DLCs, that means district level committees. Then DLCs should take steps to ensure recognition of their rights. Then the state government need to make all out effort to recognize the rights. And also they have to intimate this Ministry of Tribal Affairs on the steps taken towards recognition of rights in the periodic report submitted by them. So this is a procedure for that. Okay, and it is not the duty of Ministry of Indian Forest and Climate Change in order to vest the or in order to declare the habitat rights. So that's why third statement is wrong. So here our answer is A, 1 and 2. Now this is a question regarding a plant species, okay, an invasive plant species in India, and that is Cimacarivellan, or we can call it as Prosopis juliflora. Prosopis juliflora is the scientific name of the Cimacarivellan species, and we know that Cimacarivellan species, it is a invasive species to India and mainly in the Tamil Nadu region, right? And this Tamil Nadu government, they were eradicating this Cimacarivellan species because it was creating damages to the water table and also damages to the biodiversity in that region, because it was using the water in an abundant manner and it was spreading their roots in such a way that the other plants cannot grow, right? So that's why Prosopis juliflora, it was in news related to the eradication of this species. So the question is like this: why is a plant called Prosopis juliflora often mentioned in news? Option A, its extract is widely used in cosmetics. Then B, it tends to reduce the biodiversity in the area in which it grows. And C, its extract is used in the synthesis of pesticides. And D, none of the above. So here our answer is B, because Prosopis juliflora or Cimacarivellan, it was using the, or it was the reason for reducing the water table in Tamil Nadu region, and it was causing damage to the other species, plant species, because they are spreading their roots anything like else. So that's why other plants cannot grow there. So thereby it was reducing the biodiversity in that region. So here our answer is B, Prosopis juliflora, it was reducing the biodiversity in the regions of Tamil Nadu like that. So this was the question we discussed in our model test regarding this Prosopis juliflora, that means Cimacarivellan. And the statement we have given was, it is an endemic tree to southern part of India, and it is one of the most important trees in evergreen forest areas of South India. So both of these was wrong. Okay, both these statements are wrong, because it is not an endemic species, it is a invasive species to India, and it is not an important tree in India, and also it is not to the evergreen forest. Now this is a question regarding the coral reef system. We know that coral reefs, they are the diverse underwater ecosystems, right? So here is a question regarding that. Most of the world's coral reef are in tropical waters. Then more than 1/3 of the world's coral reefs are located in the territories of Australia, Indonesia and Philippines. And third, coral reefs host far more number of animal phyla than those hosted by tropical rainforest. Here our answer is D. That means all these three statements are correct with regard to coral reef ecosystem. So the first statement, most of the world's coral reefs are found in tropical waters. That's a correct statement, because that's why we are calling it as tropical corals, right? So it require a kind of medium temperature, around 20 to 29 degrees Celsius temperature they require. So reef building corals are found in the shallow and warm waters of tropical waters and also the subtropical waters. So it is found in tropical and also subtropical waters. So why they are found in this region, tropical region? Because we know that coral reefs, they are having algae in order to produce the carbohydrates by the process photosynthesis, because they are having chlorophyll. So that's why they require sunlight. Okay, so they require sunlight and also they require a kind of temperature range in between 22 to 29 degrees Celsius. That's why they are found in the tropical regions. Okay, and also there are deep sea corals are also there, like the cold corals are there, right? Cold corals are seen in the deep of the water because they are lacking algae. But the reef building corals, they are found in the tropical regions. Okay, that's why we are calling it as tropical corals. Then more than half of the world's corals, it is distributed in mainly 5 countries, like the Indonesia, Australia, Philippines, France and Papua New Guinea. So in these 5 states or 5 countries is the world's half of the corals are spreading over. So that's why second statement is also correct. Okay, that in more than 1/3 of the world's coral reefs are located in the territories of Australia, Indonesia and Philippines. So we know that Great Barrier Reef, it is found in the Australia. Even from the space, we can see the Great Barrier Reef in Australia, right? So that much area it covers. The Great Barrier Reef of Australia, it covers that much area. Then third statement is also correct. Coral reefs host far more number of animal phyla than those hosted by tropical rainforest. So by the estimated calculations, around 32 of the 34 recognized animal phyla, they are found in these coral reefs compared to 9 phylas found in the tropical forest. So by the estimations, there are 9 phylas in the tropical forest, okay, and also around 32 of the 34 recognized phyla, it is found in coral leaves. That means the third statement is correct. Coral leaf host far more number of animal phyla than those hosted by tropical rainforest. So coral leaf consisting of more than 30 animal phyla than that of this tropical rainforest phyla. So third is also correct statement. So here our answer is D. All these three statements are correct.